Welcome back to Halo Canon, everyone. As I'm sure you've noticed, I didn't really make an attempt at a humorous intro this time around. What could that mean, you ask? Well, simply put, I didn't really have any major bullshit to complain about this time. While the art is still horrendous and the pacing is nothing short of terrible, I found that overall this issue wasn't that bad, and the ending was actually quite enjoyable. So, without further ado, let's dive right in. We start pretty much where the last issue left off. John is in the Didact's clutches, his head about to be popped like a grapefruit. Blue Team tries to distract the Didact, so the Didact throws John at them. Come on, Didact! You said you were done fucking around in the last issue, and now, just as you're about to kill John, you throw him at Blue Team, effectively freeing him? You can manipulate gravity with your armor. You could brush Blue Team aside with the flick of your wrist. Literally. Okay, I know I said I liked this issue, but heads up, there is still some stupid bullshit. That all said, the next scene does finally seem to respect the Halo source material. While Fred is busy catching John with his body, Kelly is able to dodge and get a shot in on the Didact, while also opening a window for Linda to get in on the action. Unfortunately for them, the Didact remembers that he's an 11-foot walking tank and disarms the Spartans. It's at this point that we get one of the most confusing lines in the issue.
Something's happening! He's shaking off direct hits!
Okay, and I really don't get this line. The Didact has done nothing but shake things off the whole time. The guy is fighting with a freaking knife in the eye, and the fact that he's taking shots to his highly advanced armor is the surprising part? God damn the writing in this story arc. With Blue Team all but defeated, the Didact finally pulls out the knife from his chest. You know, I haven't really directly complained about the art for a while, so let's talk. This scene right here, it looks like he's pulling the knife from his chest. I mean, come on, Dark Horse! These are supposed to be professional comic artists, and they can't even get perspective right? Moving forward, the Didact allows Fred to shoot him in the face. Because reasons. Okay, let's stop and talk again. There are two main schools of thought concerning this scene. The first is, what? Like, why would the Didact allow this? Sure, he can take it. Sure, he knows that he can take it. But that doesn't make it any less confusing. The other is that some part of the old Didact, from before he was corrupted, is still in there. Recall his treatment of Fourth Enko before the Lord of Admirals was composed.
Know this, relentless enemy, killer of our children, Lord of Admirals. Soon we will face the enemy you have faced. And we are afraid.
Could some part of the Didact still be in there? Could this be hinting that the Didact might finally find redemption? A number of lore fans have been considering such a story arc in future media, and if that were part of 343's plan, this moment suddenly makes a lot more sense. Anyway, just as the Didact is about to finish fucking around, again, 859 Static Carillion shows up to teleport the Didact to, as we soon find out, the Halo's control room. According to Carillion, it was the only choice he had. Luckily, the activation index was somehow not teleported with him. Given the Didact's location and his immunity to anything else Blue Team can throw at him, John decides to use the only weapon that the Didact can't adapt to, the Halo Ring itself. We flash forward to the Didact in the control room, noting that something must be up, and John shows up just in time to confirm it, Blue Team having returned to their longsword. They exchange words because, shit, it's not like the Didact wants to kill John or anything, and John places the activation index into the control panel. The Didact rightly asks John why he would resort to such a plan to fire the Halo to kill him, and John notes that while this was his original plan, Static Carillion reminded him that Halo had an effective range of 25,000. It seems that the Halos only have an effective range of 25 light years, not 25,000. I guess all the media up until now is wrong, right? Or perhaps it's just another technical oversight, right? Right? So Static Carillion had proposed a different plan. As John braces himself, he reveals this plan to the Didact. Step 1, deactivate the Halo's safety protocols. Step 2, eject their section of the ring to the planet below. And let's stop and talk again. In Halo Primordium, it was revealed that Halos could indeed shed damaged sections. This is further expanded upon in Halo Silentium. At the time, I was under the impression that this was a feature unique to the original 12-ring array, but it seems that I was mistaken. So initially this seemed kind of frustrating to me, but as I thought more about it, it could be argued that the feature was a good safety protocol, and could easily have been included in the new Halo design. Anyway, the section of Halo crashes on the Composer's Forge, and then... I'm actually not sure what happened. At first glance, it looks like something exploded and disintegrated the Didact, but I'm not sure what. I would think that part of the control room did it, but in the next scene, the whole control room looks entirely intact. As I look over the scene more carefully, it finally occurred to me what must have happened. The Didact was composed. If we look carefully, he lands next to the five remaining composers. The very next page, we see the familiar orange energy associated with the composer, and the final scene is very reminiscent of the composition process. Of course, the major problem here is...
That leaves only the composer.
It will not work on my new form.
So, how could the Didact be composed if he's immune? Could something have happened that involves the composers but isn't composition? Let's look again at the exact words the Didact uses.
It will not work on my new form.
The composer will not work on his new form. What exactly does that mean? A lot of fans automatically assume this means immunity, since those are the words that the librarian uses when she advances John's evolution.
Reclaimer, the gene song I placed within you contains many gifts, including an immunity to the composer. But it must...
However, when we look at the scene where John is exposed to the composer's radiation, it still affects him. Not in the way it's meant to, but it still knocks him out. So, could immunity be the wrong word? Might resistance be the actual word? Could it be that more composers would actually do the work? Or could it be that the composers would work on the Didact, but not turn him into an AI? Or maybe it just comes down to more bullshit. On board the Longsword, it is revealed that the Monitor was able to teleport John off the ring in time. With all seemingly well, Static Carillion takes the Halo for repairs and safekeeping. Where he's taking it, though, is unknown. Could this further hint at a return to the Ark? Is there another installation out there capable of repairing a Halo? So many questions, and this is one part of the comic I absolutely loved. Solid groundwork for a future subplot. Back at Earth, a full 72 hours after the attack on New Phoenix, John is debriefed by Lord Hood, who orders him and Blue Team to relax. Instead, John returns to his team, telling them they've been ordered back into the field. When Kelly asks where, John replies, "Anywhere we're needed." The comic ends with a discussion between two unknown Oni agents, commenting on Lord Hood's anger regarding John's disobeying his orders, and noting that John is refusing to stop, taking one mission after another. Our final words from these agents are, "Something's gotta give. He can't keep doing this to himself forever."
Yeah, but if he wants to destroy himself, hell, who's gonna stop him?
I got chills reading this for the first time. So let's break down these final scenes. John is certainly showing signs of PTSD. He doesn't want to stop, to be forced to think about what happened to Cortana and likely the loss that he's experienced throughout his life. He's close to a breaking point, and only 343 knows what will happen when the floodgates finally open. We know that John is disobeying orders from Lord Hood. Could it be that John, and perhaps Blue Team with him, will go AWOL between now and Halo 5, prompting Hood to send Agent Locke after him? And if Blue Team is indeed with John, it's exciting to think about the co-op possibilities for Halo 5. I love the idea that Blue Team could be co-op characters, and if they do stick with John, that's certainly a possibility. I know at this point someone is going to point out the fact that John was alone in the E3 2013 trailer, but remember, this is just a concept trailer, much like any Halo announcement video. What we've seen isn't necessarily going to be reflected in the final product. It's also important that we talk about the Didact. We see him disintegrated or composed or whatever. But at the end, John is reluctant to say that the Didact is dead or defeated. Contained is the exact word used. We've known for a while that the Didact is supposed to be a recurring character throughout the Reclaimer saga, so we know he's not dead. I would again cite the fact that Jewel Umdama seems to have easy access to a number of Requiem systems in Spartan Ops, and that the Prometheans readily obey his orders. I can only imagine that such command would only be given by the Didact himself. We also have to wonder how the Prometheans from Installation 03 would have gotten to Requiem, or how Jewel would have gotten his hands on a Promethean soul without the Didact's help. So many questions that can only be answered by the Didact's survival. So in the end, I did like this issue more than the last two, if my lack of shouting has been any indication, but really, that's only because of the ending. the chiefs, not the Didacts. Overall, this story arc was a horrid waste of time, though for different reasons than I had originally thought. And it didn't feel like it advanced anything. It's almost like reading Mortal Dictata again, minus the blinding rage. Sort of. Looking forward, the next several issues will be written by a new writer, and I can only hope he brings something fresh to the table. Recently, the cover for issue 13 was revealed, along with the description.
Requiem has been destroyed. But the real war between Commander Sarah Paula's Spartans and Jewel of Dama's new covenant is just beginning. Everything hinges on control of one all-powerful artifact.
There is a Covenant cultist leader outside. What I have is not for him.
This summer, Halo Escalation.
So, assuming that Dark Horse isn't bullshitting us again, what could this mean? I like that we're getting back to Jewel's story, but what is this new artifact? Could it be the Janus Key? Could it be the Absolute Record? The Ark? Something else? My first instinct would say the Janus Key, since that's where Spartan Ops left off, but only time will tell. Anyway, that's it for this issue of Halo Escalation. Stay tuned to Halo Canon, and I'll see you next time, Spartans. Hey guys, thanks for watching my video. It means a lot. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up, subscribe, and maybe share it around on whatever social media you choose. Your support is greatly appreciated. I cannot stress that enough. Thanks for watching.